Hello everybody, I hope that you are all enjoying this open source summit. For my part, I'm very happy to show you how to program extensions for Kubernetes and kubectl using the Go language. My name is Philippe Martin, I'm a developer for the Sphere company in France, and I'm a contributor for the Kubernetes project, essentially around the documentation translation and the translation of the Kubernetes dashboard. I am participating this year to the season of docs to try to make the API references more accessible on the web. And I have published a book to help you prepare for the Kubernetes certifications. And I'm also editing two books about API reference and the kubectl reference. During this presentation, I will first make a quick tour about the Kubernetes API. Then I will talk about the client Go library and how to create a kubectl plugin using this library. Next, I will talk about the controller runtime library and then how to create an operator using the kubebuilder framework that uses this controller runtime library. So first, let's talk about the Kubernetes API. The Kubernetes API is the entry point for everybody that wants to talk with the Kubernetes cluster. Either you are a human and using the kubectl command, or a program like the control plane components or cloud native applications. All will pass through this API to talk with the cluster. So this API is a standard HTTP REST API, and the Kubernetes team provides a specification in the Open API format. An Open API specification is composed of different parts and specifically a list of paths and a list of definitions. A path is the URL you are using to request this API, and for each path, the specification gives the different operations possible for this path, like get, post, patch, and so on. And for each operation, what are the parameters and what is the response? And for each parameter and responses, these parameters and responses can be function of definitions. The definitions are the structures of data you are passing or getting to the API. The Kubernetes API has two concepts, the Kubernetes actions and kinds. The action is directly mapped to the operations, and the kinds are some of the definitions. For example, on the right side, you can see that for a pod, there are different operations. There is the operation get to read a specified pod, the operation list to list kinds, the operation create to create a pod, and so on. And the kind is directly the pod here, the pod object. So about the Kubernetes actions, when you are using them when you are creating roles for the RBAC system of your cluster. So here, as an example, if you want to make available the get, watch, and list verbs for the pods, you create this role. The verbs here are the same as the action we are talking about. When using kubectl, you are also using these different actions. For example, when running kubectl get pod nginx, you are running a get action. And with kubectl get pods, you are using the list action, and so on with the other commands. We can see with the access matrix plugin, the list of verbs or actions and the list of kinds that are available in the cluster, and what are the rights for the given user. So here I am running this command as a cluster admin user, and so I can get access to all the actions for all the kinds. If I am running the same command but for the default service account of the default namespace, we can see that this service account do not have any right to run any action for any kind. The Kubernetes kinds are the Kubernetes objects you are using regularly, like pods, deployments, ingresses, and so on. Each kind belongs to a given group and version. For example, the pod belongs to the core V1, the deployment to the apps V1, and the ingress to the networking.kubernetes.io/V1 group and version. And when you are creating your Kubernetes template to use with kubectl, you are giving the kind with the kind field and the group and version with the API version field. Now we have seen an overview of the API. Let's talk about the ClientGo library. This ClientGo library can be used by any program to access the Kubernetes API. For this, you can start a new project with the gomod init command as usual, and you can specify a specific version of the library with the go-get kubectl.io ClientGo with the version you want to use. The first thing to do when creating a program is to connect to the cluster. There are two different cases: either your program will run outside of the cluster or inside the cluster. If your program runs outside the cluster, you will have to specify the kubeconfig file to use with this command. And if your program is running into the cluster, you don't have to specify anything because the library will know how to get the credentials to connect to this cluster. It will use the credentials mounted into the container of the service account used for the pod on which the container is running. And it will connect to the API of the current cluster. Next, you have to create a client set. And this client set contains a set of clients. And it will contain a client for each group and version. For example, running client set core V1, you will get the client for the core V1 group. And then, if you want to run actions for this API, you first have to select a kind into this group. Here, the nodes kind. And then, finally, you can run the list action into this kind. So here, to run the list action on the nodes, you can run this command. If you want to list the pods, you have to specify a namespace. And so you can specify it here. If you want to list all the pods for all the namespaces, you have to specify an empty namespace name. And if you want to get a specific resource, you just have to pass the name of this resource in the get method. If you want to pass more options to your action, for example, here to get to list pods with a specific selector, you can pass the label selector option. To know which options are available, you can look at the documentation of the API. Here, for example, for the list of pods, you can see all the parameters available for this action. You can find allow watch bookmarks, continue, fit selector, label selector, and so on. And on the left, you can see that these options are also available in the list options structure. Allow watch bookmarks, limit, label selector, field selector, and so on. And this is true for all the actions. If you want to create a resource, you first have to create the given structure, the given Go structure. You can find how to import this structure also with the documentation. here for the pod resource, you have an import with the path to import the corresponding package. And so you can import it, give it another name, because elsewhere all would be named V1 or V1 alpha 1. And so you can find the resources inside these packages. And you are creating the structure, you can see that the structure is completely similar to the structure of the YAML files you are writing when writing a template for kubectl. And next, you just have to call the create method, passing the pointer to the structure you just created in memory. If you want to delete an object, you just have to run the delete method, passing the name of the object. And next, if you want to watch a specific resource, you can run the watch method into this resource. This command will return a Go channel, and this channel will emit events here. And the event will contain a type and an object. The type will be added, modified, or deleted depending on what happens on your resource. And the object field will contain your object. The problem with the watch command is that it is a streaming HTTP request. And so the request will be opened by the client. The server will send the first events into this connection, but the connection won't be closed. So the server can send new events later. The problem is that some proxy will generally be between the client and the server and will shut down this connection after some tens of minutes. And so the ClientGo library provides informers that are managing for you these disconnections and reconnections. And also it will manage for you a cache that will cache data it already get from previous connections. When you are running your programs into Kubernetes managed by cloud provider, you will have to include some authentication plugins so your program, the program can negotiate tokens with the authentication system into the cloud manager. So you have to add these lines, this line or one or several of these lines to include the wanted authentication plugins. Now we have seen how to communicate with the Kubernetes API programmatically. We will see how to create a kubectl plugin. A kubectl plugin is a simple program that is available into your system path. So for example, here I have a kubectl-hello executable that will just echo hello. And it is available in my path. So if I run this command, it will echo hello. If I remove the dash, and so hello becomes the parameter of the kubectl command, the kubectl command will try to find the kubectl-hello program in the path and execute it. And so here it executes it correctly. So that's the only thing you have to do to create a kubectl plugin. You just have to name it correctly and put it in your system path. So now let's create a first plugin using the ClientGo library. Here we will describe the service tree plugin I have written recently, and that will show you all the services into a specific namespace and all the backends of these services. So the first thing the plugin is doing is to list the available services, and for each service, it will explore to find the endpoints belonging to this service, and for each endpoint it will find the target of the endpoint and find which pods are the target of the endpoints. And next, for each pod, it will explore the pods to find the containers in it and which port are exposed by each container. And so it will be able to link the services with the pods. So here, if I am deploying a little application in the demo namespace, I will deploy an Nginx deployment with two containers, an Nginx container and a Memcached container. Another Nginx deployment, but this time with a readiness probe that will fail. And an Nginx service that will expose these two previous deployments. And next, we deploy an Apache deployment and a service exposing this Apache deployment. If we run the plugin on this namespace, we can see that it has found the two services. And for each service, it displays the pods that are the backends of this service. And here, it has found that the pod is not running correctly because the readiness probe is not okay. And here, it has found that the container that is replying to the, that is listening on the 80 port is a Nginx container. Next, if you want to deploy your plugin to the crew index, you just have to create a manifest with some description of your plugin. And you have to reference the binaries that will be available for the users to download and install on their machines. When you have done this, you can create a pull request in the crew index repository. And when it is merged, your plugin will be available in the crew index. And so you can run kubectl crew search to get the list of available plugins into the index. And if you want to see which plugins are already installed in your machine, you can run crew list. And next, you can run different commands, install, uninstall, update, and so on to manage your cluster, your plugins into your machine. Now we have seen the CleanGo library and how to use it to create plugins for kubectl. We will talk about the controller runtime library, which is very useful to create controllers or operators for Kubernetes. When you create a new program with controller runtime, this time the first thing to do is always to connect to the cluster. And this time it is easier because you just have to use the getconfig method, and it will detect for you if the program is running outside of the cluster or inside the cluster. And it will also find the kubeconfig file for you. Either it is passed by the kubeconfig flag or described into the kubeconfig environment variable, or if none of these are set, it will try to connect as if the program is running inside the cluster. And finally, if nothing of this is working, it will try to connect using the kubeconfig file into your home directory. This time, to run actions into the API, you just have to get a client. If you here with the client new command, and you can run actions directly into this client. Ici, here, you are running the create command, passing a pod object. And this pod object is like with the client go library, a pod structure. If you want to list the pods, you can run the list action into the client directly, passing the options you want. Now, let's see how to create a controller using this library. into the Kubernetes cluster, all controllers are running into the same program named the Kube Controller Manager. And this manager will manage all the controllers, either the deployment controller, or the replicas controller, or the service controller, and so on. And so, if you are creating controllers yourself, you also have to create one manager, and this manager will manage one or several of your controllers. So here, you create a manager with this first line. Then you create a controller that we attach to the manager. And finally, we start the manager. When creating your controller, you just have to specify a reconciler method. The reconciler method is the method that will be called every time the resources that are interest for this controller will be modified or added or deleted. For this, you have to watch the specific resources the controller is interested in. Here, it will watch the pod resource, and we will talk it to enqueue this resource, and so this resource will be sent to the reconciler method. Here is the reconcile method that will get here the request, and it in this request, it will get the name and the namespace of the objects to reconcile. And so here it will get pods because the controller is watching pods. In this example, we create a controller that will watch for pods, and each time a pod is created, it will create a service that will expose this pod. So for this, it first gets the pod, it gets the name and namespace of a pod, so it will try to get this pod into the cluster, into the real cluster, and if this pod does not exist, the controller understands that the pod has been deleted, and so it does not have anything to do. But if the pod exists, it will try to see if there are some annotation specific to this controller. So here we have defined a demo expose annotation, and this annotation exists in the pod. It will expose this pod with a service. And in the expose method, it will try to get the corresponding service, and if it does not exist yet, it will create it. And so to create it, it will create the service structure in memory, like we have seen before. And finally, it will run the create action into this structure that will create the service into the cluster. So the controller is creating services when pods are created. The controller, it would be interesting that the controller knows about what happens to these services. And for this, it can watch the services. Here with this watch command, it will look at services. And we query that this time, the owner of the service is enqueued into the reconcile method. Because the reconcile method only accepts pods, is only interested about pods. And here we are listening about service. So we want to get the object for which the service has been created. For this, when creating the service, we can define the controller of the service and specify that this is the pod that is the controller of the service. And here in the watch, we query to enqueue the owner of the service that is the pod. So let's run this controller to see how it is working. So the controller is running. We will create a pod Nginx. For the moment, nothing happened because there is no corresponding annotation. So we will add this annotation. And now we have seen that the controller has created the service. We can use our previous plugin we have created. And we can see that the service is correctly exposing the pod. And we can see that the service exists. Now, we will delete the pod. And because the pod is the controller of the service, and the service is referenced as owned by the pod, there is a garbage collector that will delete all the objects for which the owner is not present anymore. And so we can see that the service has been removed. It has not been removed by our controller, but by the garbage collector provided by the Kubernetes control plane. In the other way, if we are creating again our pod, the service will be created. And if we try to delete this service, we can see that it has been created again because the controller has detected that this service has been deleted, and so it resaved events into the watch command and emit and call the reconciler with the pod, and this pod recreated this service because the service did not exist. Now we have seen how the controller runtime can be used to create a controller. We will use the Kube Builder framework, which gives more tools to create controllers using this library. So, as an example, we try to write a controller that will help you deploy static websites. Here is an example of a static website deployed with a deployment. The deployment contains one init container that will download files from a specific bucket into the cloud, save these files into a local mount, and the container will run the Nginx server with the downloaded files. And there is a service to expose this pod and a horizontal pod autoscaler to autoscale this deployment. So if we use this template for a static website, that works. But we can see that there are different parameters and we would like to parameterize our deployments. Here we have the size of the volume we will use to store files downloaded from the bucket. There is the address of the bucket from which to download files, and there are the min and max number of replicas for our pod. And we would like to parameterize our deployment with this. So for this, we will create an operator with a new kind, which is named static. So for this, we can create a new project with GoMod init, and then initialize the KubeBuilder project, giving your specific domain, and then we create a new CRD with a create API command, giving a specific group, a specific version, and a specific kind. These are the kind, group, and version we were talking about at the beginning of the talk. And so we will add a new group and version to the API and a new kind into this group and version. And so this command will create a new resource, so a new CRD, and create a controller that will control this resource. Let's examine what are the sources generated by the tool. So here it will create a manager, like we have seen before. It will set up a new controller. Here, static reconciler. It will set up it with our manager, and then it will start a manager. So very similar to what we have seen before. The reconciler, yeah, we can find the reconciler method, which for the moment is empty. And we can see that the setup with manager will create a new controller, and it will use the for method, that is a utility method to make the watches we have seen before. So here it will watch the static resource, and it will enqueue this resource into the reconcile method. And so we know that the reconcile method will receive static resources. And the structure of the new CRD, it can be found here. It is composed of metadata and the spec structure and status structure. The spec structure contains a sample field foo, and the status structure is empty. So we have seen that we would like to add four parameters: the disk size that will contain the files downloaded, the source, the URI of your bucket, and the min and max replicas for your pod. So you can define it in the static spec structure here. And now we can start to implement the operator. So yeah, the operator is a reconcile method. Each time a static resource is created, we would like to create a deployment, create a service, and create an horizontal spot autoscaler. So we call this method here, and we can see what happens when we create the deployment. So first, we will create the deployment structure in memory with all the parameters. And we will use here as the size limit of our volume, we will use the static spec, the spec of our static object. We will get the disk size of our CRD, and we'll use it as a size limit into the volume of our deployment. And elsewhere, we will pass as environment variable, as source, we will pass the source spec of our static object. And when this deployment Go structure is created, we can run the create action to create this deployment really into the cluster. And the same thing is done for the service and for the HPA. When your controller will be running into the cluster, by default, it will use a service account that won't get any right to run any action on any resource. And so you have to create some role with specific resources. And so here, we can write a specific comments that will be handled by a kubebuilder, and that we create an equivalent role with this rights. And so here, by default, when the controller source code is created by kubebuilder, it will give access to all the actions for your static resource into this group. And so by default, the generated role, you can find that for the resource static, you have the controller have access to these actions. So now, because the controller will create deployment services and HPI, you have to add the specific rights. And so you can add these three lines that contain, that declare that you want the controller to be able to get this watch and so on for the deployment, for the services, and for the horizontal pod autoscalers. And when running the Cube Builder tool, it will update your role used by the controller pod by adding rights for the horizontal pod autoscaler deployment and service. We have seen that we have to declare the controller for each of the objects that are created by the controller. So when the controller, the custom resource. And so when the custom resource is deleted, all the created objects will be deleted at the same time. And so here again, we are defining the controller for all the objects we are creating. Here the deployment. And we add, when you create the controller, we add after the for, we have seen before that that declares that the static will be watched and enqueued into the reconcile method. This time we can use the utility method owns that declares that the controller owns also deployment, service, and horizontal pod autoscaler. And so for this resource, the owns tells to enqueue this time not the resource itself but the owner of this resource, which are static resources. Now when the website is deployed, we want to know the status of the website. For example, how replicas are running, what is the IP of the load balancer that is exposing the pods, and so on. So for this, we have to use the status sub-resource. So for this, the first thing to take care is to declare with this specific comment that we are using the sub-resource status. Elsewhere, this will not work. And here, when some events are coming into the reconcile, when the reconcile method is called because some deployment has been modified, for example, all the reconcile code we have seen before is called again. And so here, when we apply the deployment, if before we tried to create this deployment, but if it is already created, we can look at its status, and from this status, we can compute the status of the static custom resource and update it if necessary. So here, we can get the number of replicas for a deployment and update the status of the static object to put this number of replicas. Each time the controller is doing something important, it is interesting to get some information into the kubectl describe command for this object. Generally, into the pod, you get information when the pod is started, when it mounts some volume, and so on. And so it is interesting to log these events for our custom resource. For this, you can use the record package of the client Go library. And we can add a recorder into the structure of our controller. And finally, we can use this recorder to send events. So each time the controller is doing something important, here it has created, it has updated the number of replicas, for example, we can, through this recorder, we can send a new event, which is of type normal, and with some text to indicate what is happening. when you are running the command kubectl get pods, for example, you get different columns with specific information about pods. For our static of resource, we would like to get also specific information, for example, the source of the bucket that is used for this static website, or the number of actual replicas of pods. And so for this, we also use this specific comment. Here we declare the name of the colon, and from this path into the structure, we get the value for this colon. For the colon source, we get its value from the source into the spec structure. And the external IP colon will get its value from the external IP into the status of the custom resource. These comments are transformed by the kubebuilder command. When it creates the CRD, here we find it creates the additional printer columns feed of the CRD, and these columns are handled directly by the kubectl program to display them. It is very important to write a test for your controller so you are sure that the controller is behaving normally and that it is doing what exactly what you want it does. So here a framework is provided by kubebuilder, and so for example you can create that when a static resource is created, you can verify that a static website in the cluster is created by creating a deployment, and that this deployment is owned by the static resource, and that an event is created with the type create deployment. Then that it has created a service owned by the static resource and created a specific event, and also an horizontal pod autoscaler with a specific event. The next series of tests can be that when your website is created, if the replica count of the deployment changes, then the replica value in the static status also changes. Or when the external IP of the service changes, the external IP value into the status also changes with the same value, and so on for here we can verify that if some user are updating the resources created by the controller, for example the deployment, the service or the horizontal pod autoscaler, the controller will modify back the resource as the controller wants. So for example, here when the website has been deployed and the deployment strategy is rolling update, as the controller said, and if the deployment strategy is changed to recreate by another user, so the controller will change back to the original strategy. And the same, by default, the controller put 80 for the port of the service. If a user changes the port to 8080, the controller will change back the port to 80. And same thing for the horizontal pod autoscaler. If a user changes the min or max replica, the controller will change it back to its original value. So now, a demo about this controller. We will verify that the CRD has been deployed. That's okay. We can see here a specific website we want to deploy. So we will get the sources of the website from this bucket. And we want the replicas from 1 to 4 replicas. So for this, we will create this custom resource. and we can see with the three very interesting three plugins for Kubectl that which show the objects that belong to our resource, to our static resource. So here, the controller has created for this resource a deployment, an HPA, and a service. And the deployment, for the deployment, some replica has been created, and for this replica, some pod has been created. Now we can see that the status has been updated for our object. It has an external IP and the number of replicas. And we can run a describe into this resource. And we can see that events have been sent for this object. And finally, we can run get statics to see the columns we have added for this command. And we can see the source of the files served by the website, the min and max replicas, the actual replicas, and the external IP. And that's all for the demo and for this talk. We can get the slide at this URL, and you can get the sources for the website operator and for the service tree plugin. Thank you all for your attention. Bye.